Hello everyone, my name is Ratnaguna and I have the great privilege and pleasure of talking to Prajnanandi again this morning. Hello Prajnanandi.
Hello Ratnaguna, it's good to see you again.
We've done one interview on this topic, the topic being autism and the Triratna Buddhist Community. And I had a few nice emails and texts from various people after the last one thanking me and saying how good the interview was. I'm guessing you had a few of those too, did you?
Yes, I did. I was really quite surprised by the amount of interest that there was in this as a topic. So,
yes.
Great. Yes.
Yeah, pretty good, isn't it? So, we've got a definite topic to talk about today, which is sensory processing. You chose this topic, Prajnanandi. Can you just say why you chose it and what sensory processing is? Maybe the other way around there.
Okay. Sensory processing, it's how our minds respond to sensory input. And normally we think of that as being five senses, you know, the standard sight, taste, touch, that sort of thing.
Right.
But I also feel that it's important to understand that it can also include things like how the body works with balance and how the body awareness is perceived, both internally and externally. So it's not quite what people normally think of, or we think of as five senses.
Gosh, balance is included. That really surprises me.
Yeah. You know, some people are clumsy because the mental processing for balance doesn't work properly. Some people who are autistic find this is a problem, but it also affects other people who are neurodiverse.
Gosh. So let's talk about that then for a while. So our topic really is, as I said earlier, autism or autistics. Can we call autistic people autists?
Yes, I think so. Yes, it's difficult, isn't it? That's not really a nice word. Autism has sometimes a very negative connotation, but that's who we are. Yes.
I just wanted to check, because it's so easy to offend people by saying a word which you shouldn't really use. So I just wanted to check that with you.
That doesn't offend me.
Good.
But I can't say for everybody that it wouldn't.
Ah, yes, that's true.
Yes.
One of the letters that somebody sent me was, he quoted Chris Packham saying, when you've met one autistic person, you've met one autistic person.
Yes. Well, it's exactly the same as for neurotypical people. None of us would sit there and say that all neurotypical people are alike. But people quite often think that all neurodiverse people are alike.
Yeah. Yes. But there must be something that makes them similar in some ways.
Yes. I think it's difficult to find a model, but do you know what a dartboard looks like?
Dartboard?
Yeah, a dartboard.
I do know what a dartboard looks like.
Okay. Well, if you can imagine that, we've got concentric circles and we've got it split into segments. Yeah? If you think of each segment as being a way the mind processes things, and you start from not processing at all in the center to processing it a lot at the edge, then neurotypical people, people whose minds work normally, would be in a sort of circle in the middle. And people who have different sensory processing would either be below that range or above it. So we're either oversensitive or undersensitive to sensory input.
Yes.
So there's a range which is, quote, normal, and then there's everybody else who has less stimulation from sensory input or more stimulation.
Yes. Being an introvert myself, I find external stimulation too much sometimes, and I have to retire to my cave, as it were, and just be with myself for a few hours, because otherwise I lose all sense of meaning, actually, when I'm overloaded with sensory input.
Yeah, and that would be sometimes called hypersensitivity. Whereas if you need more sensory input than normal, because you don't respond to it in the normal way, that would be called hypo. You need more. You're too low, in a sense. You need more.
So I've heard from various autistic friends of mine that there's a syndrome called meltdown and shutdown. I don't know if meltdown and shutdown are the same things, but I've heard about this phenomenon.
Yeah, it's big. They are two different things, but they're related. So it's what happens if you get overwhelmed. So it could be by anything. It could be by sight, sound, smell. It could be all sorts of different things. But the brain cannot take any more in. You can then either have a fight or a freeze response.
Uh-huh.
So everybody has that to a certain extent, but it's probably more easily triggered in people who are neurodiverse.
Uh-huh.
So for example, if your response to being overwhelmed is to freeze, you may go into shutdown. And that means that actually you may physically be curled up in a little ball somewhere with your hands over your ears, trying to shut everything out.
Gosh.
Yeah? That has happened to me on an ordination retreat. I spent 3 days basically asleep.
Wow.
Because I got so completely overwhelmed by the sensory input of being in, with the same group of people in a small place 24/7. I couldn't shut it out. And as I say, it was sort of 3 days before I actually came out of that.
Gosh.
So we're not talking about a minor thing here.
No, indeed.
We're talking about something that can be a very major problem. Meltdown is responding to this with the equivalent of the fight response. So you may want to throw things or scream or be very loud or be hitting something in order to get rid of the extrasensory absolute nightmare that's going on in the mind.
Yeah. So if an autistic person were in a class or a weekend retreat, and how would those of us who are running the retreat, the order members, how would we recognize when someone's going into shutdown, and how would we recognize if they're going to meltdown?
Behavior may change. So if someone suddenly starts acting differently, ask, yeah, are you okay? Yeah?
Yes.
It might simply be that they need to go for a walk. But it might be that they need to go somewhere quiet and curl up somewhere for a little bit. Or somewhere away from people. The pressure of people is huge, actually, if you're neurodiverse.
Right.
Particularly if you're oversensitive to the sensory input.
Yes.
It's very difficult to hold that for an extended period of time.
It's obvious, I suppose, but I think I'll say it anyway. What you should not do is try to bring someone into communication if they shut down. Let's have a cup of tea together and talk it over. That probably wouldn't work, no?
They wouldn't be able to.
Right.
I was asleep for almost 3 days.
You meant that literally, asleep for 3 days and nights. Gosh.
Yeah. Not entirely, because I did eat. Yeah? But I couldn't go into the dining room to get my food. People had to come and bring it to me.
Yes.
We're not, as I say, talking about a minor thing here. It is really distressing, really debilitating, and it knocks you out for days. So if you're in the middle of a retreat situation, for example, and this happens, you may not be able to come back into the retreat. You may need to leave.
Gosh. And with a meltdown, you talked about, you know, maybe in extreme cases, throwing things and so on, maybe picking a fight. It's important for us to know that too, isn't it? Because if you, let's say, were on a retreat that I was running, then you became aggressive, would that be the kind of thing that happened? You would become aggressive?
You might be in floods of tears.
Uh-huh.
You might also be aggressive. Everybody is different. But I have a friend who, for example, on a retreat, ended up crying and crying and crying and crying because they could not process what was going on. That person is not autistic, but they are neurodiverse.
Yes. Gosh. One of the things that has occurred to me recently is in talking to you and others and watching a few YouTube videos of autistic people talking about it, what it's like to be autistic. I have a strong impression that we shouldn't, it doesn't matter what somebody is, whether they're neurotypical or neurodiverse, if they act in a way which is unusual, let's say, it doesn't mean to say that they're being awkward. It means they're doing the best they can with that particular situation, whether they're autistic or not.
Yes, I think I would very strongly agree with that. It can come across as being confrontational, as being awkward, or refusing to conform or something like that.
Yes.
But particularly if somebody doesn't know that they're neurodiverse, they are often doing the best they can.
Yes.
It is, of course, possible that someone's being malicious, but in my experience, that is very rare.
Mm.
It's actually normally that people are finding it difficult to cope for some reason or another.
Mm. Yes. Let's talk about noise tolerance, thresholds of.
Yeah. Well, this is one that is very strong for me, actually. I am hypersensitive to sound, partly why I've got these ear defenders on this time. So I can hear you, but I'm not distracted by everything else that's going on around me.
They're ear defenders. They're not headphones.
They're both.
Oh, okay.
Yes. Yeah. So I can hear you coming directly into my ears.
Wow.
And I'm not being distracted by the sounds that are around me, which you may not be able to hear, but I can if I'm here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So for me, a very little noise is enough. So being, for example, in a crowded reception area, doing a tea break in a centre, well, I don't do it. Even if I'm leading the class, I don't do it. I'm either in the shrine room or I found my quiet space.
Yes.
And what I've discovered, interestingly, is since I've started going to a quiet space, other people have said, "Ooh, is there a quiet space?" Yes.
Wow.
And so there's five or six of us usually in that quiet space because we can't cope with between 25 and 50 people in one room.
Yes.
And that's not necessarily because we're neurodiverse. It may simply be, for example, that you're deaf.
Yes.
And that you can't actually hear in a crowd.
Yes. Or you might be very hard of hearing as I am. And I've got good hearing aids. I've got them on now, actually. And but the downside of them is they're really good. And in a crowded situation, I just can't hear what the person opposite me is saying because of all the other noise coming in from everywhere else.
So this is a situation in which being aware of this can help so many people.
Mm. Yes.
It's just we need designated quiet areas.
So that's a thing that we could do, isn't it? Let's say the Manchester Buddhist Centre, we could say at the beginning of the class, we're going to go to a tea break now, but if anyone would like a quiet time, there's a room just over there. You can go in there and whoever's in there has to be quiet. That could be a good thing to do.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. But it's not just voices. So for me, for example, I find chanting very difficult.
Ah, yeah, you said that last time.
Yeah, that is because I have synesthesia as well.
Oh.
I feel sound.
Gosh.
Yes. So the connections in the brain are slightly different. So I feel and see sound. And with chanting, which is repetitious, it's as if someone is hitting me in the same place the whole time.
Gosh.
Yeah?
Gosh.
And after a bit, it's like sitting on top of a road drill inside a tin box.
Now, you said you have synesthesia as well.
Yes.
Is that an autistic trait or not?
It can be. But the fact that you've got synesthesia doesn't necessarily mean that you're autistic.
Well,
it just means that you're neurodiverse.
Yes, yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. So just out of interest, you've talked about the bodily aspect of synesthesia, but you said you see sound as well, do you?
Yes. I get interference patterns.
Uh-huh.
If you've ever done any physics, it's the standard physics interference patterns that you get from young slit or something experiments, which I see across my eyes, particularly if the sound has a strong attack and is energetic.
Yes.
I get woof across my eyes.
Wow.
Yes.
Wow. Okay.
So that can be rather wonderful because it's synesthesia gives you a really strong whole body experience.
Right.
But it can also be very difficult if you're in a long, very active set of chanting.
Right.
I quite often have to leave.
Yes.
I can't hold it anymore.
Yes. But you have also said in the past that the threshold for noise for an autistic person can be higher and it can be lower than that neurotypical person.
So for me, the threshold is lower. I'm oversensitive to it. But if the threshold was higher, I might need to speak very loudly all the time.
Oh, uh-huh.
Otherwise, I can't hear it. I can't connect with it. I may want there to be more noise because that gives me the sensory input that I need. Banging doors might not be a problem for me. It might be what I do as I go out of a room.
Yes.
So it's because it could be either, it's very difficult to say it's going to be one or the other.
Yes.
Within a Buddhist situation.
Uh-huh. And is it that some autistic people have a high threshold and others have a low threshold? Or is it the one person who sometimes it's high and sometimes it's low?
My own experience is that my thresholds tend to be fairly constant. But I also know that you can, for example, be oversensitive, say, to sound and undersensitive to smell or something like that. It's not that these are different senses.
Yes.
So the way the brain is actually wired, if you like to call it like that, is different for each sense.
Okay. Yes.
It's not just a blanket thing.
So let's just remind ourselves that we're talking about autistic people and Triratna. And especially we're thinking about when a community is together, as in a class or on a retreat situation. And all these things have to be borne in mind, I guess, by the people running the retreat. Well, everyone on the retreat, really, or the class.
Yes, and it's the sort of thing that people forget.
Ah.
Yeah.
They think, oh, you'll get used to it.
Aha. Uh-huh.
Yes. Give it a go.
Wow.
You'll get used to it. It's just that you don't understand and you don't, you know, you're not used to doing it.
Yes.
There is some truth in that. But I will never be normally sensitive, for example, to sound.
Yes.
It's not going to happen.
Yes.
I can, to an extent, get used to it. If there's a very, very good reason for me being there, I can override my responses.
Does that have a knock-on effect afterwards, though?
Yes. I'm exhausted.
Right. Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
You know, I really am exhausted, and that can take me several days to actually come back from.
Yes. And I'm thinking now of, let's say, two or three order members who are running a class, and they know you've got you in the class or someone like you, and you tell them, I can't do this. And I suppose the difficulty they've got is they feel they don't have the resources to give you everything that you need because there's too many people here and they can't be everywhere at once. You know, the order members have got to be in the class with other people. I guess there's a kind of pressure they feel.
Yes, absolutely. And I lead classes. I feel that pressure. I can't do everything for everybody.
Yes.
What I've found helps, though, is talking. You know, if you talk to the person and the person says, I may need to slip out of the chanting.
Yes.
But this is not because it's all going wrong or because I'm actually in a difficult, you know, something dreadful has happened. It's simply that I may need to slip out while you're chanting. Yes. Yeah. So I'm going to sit by the door.
Ah, I was just going to say sit by the door. Here's something that an order member could do if they know there's an autistic person in the class and they're going to do some chanting. They make sure there's a seat near the door for that person.
Yeah. Or just suggest, where do you want to sit?
Uh-huh.
Yes?
Yes.
You know? And it may be that for different events, you need to be in a different place.
Uh-huh. Yes.
So, for example, if I'm leading at the class, I can't be sitting at the back by the door. You have to be aware for each individual circumstance what it is that is going to work today.
Okay.
And it's not necessarily constant. If we're really tired, then we're probably more hypersensitive.
Mm.
You know?
Yes.
And If we're stressed or anxious, we are also likely to be more affected by what's going on. And that, you know, you can be stressy going on retreat for a first time, can't it?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. So let's stay in the shrine room. We were in the shrine room.
Yeah, in the shrine room.
And there's a meditation going on. Someone's leading a meditation. How is that for autistic people?
Well, interestingly, it's often one of the strengths of autism. We have the ability quite often to do what we're asked to do. So if somebody says, as they did to me on my very first meditation, clear your mind, well, I did. And I have met other autistic people who had exactly the same experience.
Gosh.
Yes.
Nathan.
So it's often possible that autistic people go very, very deeply into, for example, the dhyanas very quickly.
Yes.
Because they haven't got all the extraneous what's going on in the mind. And this is a quiet place. A peaceful place, a safe place. So yes, you can just open to it.
And it is that across the board, most autistic people readily?
I can't say. I haven't talked to most autistic people. I have met other autistic people, though, who had a similar experience. But I've also met autistic people who didn't.
Yeah, okay. So it's a possibility.
Yeah. It's a possibility. And then, if that's a beginner who's just gone straight into the first dhyana and has no idea what has happened to them, they may well come out of that needing a bit of contact with somebody.
Yes. What's happened?
Yes. What is that?
Yeah.
That was my response coming out. What was that?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah?
I am.
It was great. It was wonderful, but I had absolutely no idea what it was.
Wow. Lucky you.
Yeah. Thank you.
Well, on our last interview, we talked about myth and metaphor and how it doesn't really work, certainly for you, and I believe most autistic people don't respond very well to myth and metaphor. They're much more cognitive and much more literal, I think. Is that correct?
Yes.
So what about beauty? How do autistic people respond to beauty?
You see, that's a very interesting question. Would you ask that for somebody who was neurotypical? How do you respond to beauty? You might, mightn't you? But you wouldn't necessarily expect everybody to have the same response.
That's true. Yes.
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 Yes. I could tell you how I respond to beauty.
Oh.
Which is, I see very clearly. I see relationships and patterns. I see interconnectedness. It's very difficult to put into words. And when I sometimes try and talk about that to people, they don't see what I'm seeing. So I think there can be a very deep absorption in beauty if you are neurodiverse.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. And does that answer your question, Ratnaguna? Is that what you're interested in?
It's the beginning of an answer. Yes. You just said something about you can see connections and so on. And in our previous interview, you said you were a scientist.
Yes.
What kind of scientist were or are you?
I'm a physicist.
Physicist.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And I guess mathematics is involved in physics.
It is to an extent. So I do see mathematical patterns sometimes. But interestingly, I also have a form of dyscalculia. So I could only see some patterns.
Uh-huh.
I can't see others.
Yes, yes.
So it's everybody is different. I can use maths very effectively. I'm not necessarily intuitively mathematical.
Okay. Now, the reason I ask that question is because mathematicians tell us that maths is very beautiful. And
yes.
When you said you could see connections, I thought, oh, I wonder if that's the kind of thing that they mean.
I do mean something like that, but there's more than that.
Uh-huh.
So if I see a colour, I know why it's that colour.
Why?
Yes. Why is the sky blue? Is a standard question in physics.
Yes.
And the answer to that is to do with light and particles and how things behave and how things connect. And so when I see the colour green, I don't just see green, I see the connections.
You see them or you know them?
Well, how do I know? I know them, I think, is better. Perhaps see was a, perhaps a, but I experience the connections.
Ah, yes. So your experience of looking at the colour green, let's say a green lawn, is informed also by an awareness of how and why that lawn looks green to you.
Yes, absolutely. And so it's incredibly beautiful. It's about the nature of how things are.
Uh-huh.
It isn't just a colour.
Yes. I want to talk to you about music in a moment, because we've mentioned synesthesia, and the 20th century French composer Olivier Messiaen was famously synesthetic. He used to see his music in colours. And,
yes.
And so is it similar for you with music?
It's not colours for me, but it is, as I said, touch and sight.
That's fun.
So I see patterns, but the patterns are generally black and white.
Ah, okay. Right.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Whereas I know people who see the note G as a colour.
Ah.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Or who hear the colour blue.
Blue. Yellow. Yes.
Or the word red may actually appear to be a different colour. It's a rich and fascinating extra set of connections.
Yes.
So it's not a problem.
Oh.
It is something that enriches life.
Well, no. And yeah. As we were talking in the last interview as well as this one, I thought we're talking quite a lot about the problem in a way of being an autistic person within a spiritual community, specifically our spiritual community, and all the difficulties they face and so on. But at the moment, you're giving me a lot. I'm getting a lot out of this conversation. So I think we need to remember that too, don't we? That autistics can also give a community a lot.
We see the world differently.
No.
If you see that as a problem, then I am going to be a problem for you.
Yes.
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 Yeah. But if you see it as, gosh, isn't that fascinating?
Uh-huh.
Then it is a richer experience being with somebody who sees the world differently.
No, no, no. Yes.
Yeah, people are really different. All living beings are different.
We are.
And if we can hold that,
yes,
we can come to something that is altogether more engaging and more inclusive. It's when it's seen as a problem.
Yes.
That the difficulties start.
Yes, yes. Something that I noticed many, many years ago when I was doing quite a lot of teaching is that teaching a whole bunch of people together can be a rather blunt instrument, because you're saying certain things which some people will really respond to, but leave others either confused or leave them cold because they're different kinds of people. And I often say that in a way it'd be better if I could teach each one of you one-to-one. I got to know you, what works for you and what doesn't, then I could talk to you in ways which would be more helpful. But of course you can't do that. But I think it's really worth bearing in mind for anyone who runs a Buddhist center or runs retreats, and there are a lot of people in those situations, that what works for some won't work for others and vice versa.
Yes, I agree. And I think that's true of all people. It's not just neurodiverse people, is it? What works for some. We all have likes and dislikes. But I also think that, if I can put it this way, small changes can have a big impact. So it might be that, for example, making sure that you don't have flowers like hyacinths on the shrine, which are so incredibly floral, may actually help quite a few people in the room.
Yes.
Yes. And that's not a huge change.
Wow.
It doesn't require you to be doing anything specifically different. Man. It just needs awareness. And aren't we, you know, into awareness? Awareness is good. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
There's a lot of small changes that we could make, you know, like designating a quiet room or being careful with the lighting. And that's not big things. But there's also it can get a bit more challenging if someone is saying, I need to do it differently.
Mm-hmm.
It can get a bit more challenging. For example, for me, when I'm on retreat, almost every retreat has puja as the last thing at night. And by the time I've spent all day having to cope with sensory input, I cannot cope with a puja last thing at night. I will not sleep. I will have gone into shutdown or a sort of meltdown.
Yes. Why don't people do pujas first thing in the morning, I wonder?
I don't know. It just seems as though there is a tradition within Triratna that what we do is a puja last thing at night. Perhaps we could vary it sometimes.
Yeah.
Maybe people would get something different out of it if it was first thing in the morning or in the afternoon
even,
rather than always being last thing at night. So that was a problem when I first went on ordination retreats. Wow. I couldn't do the pujas. Yes. And I didn't know why I couldn't do it, because I didn't know at that time that I was autistic. I just knew that I couldn't.
Yes.
And because I couldn't explain it, I think that was seen as me choosing not to engage.
Picking and choosing.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes, absolutely. Yes. Yeah. Which wasn't a response that happened for long, but it wasn't helpful when I first ran across it. Yes. I think as people got to know me better, they knew that that wasn't really the case.
Yes. Now, we said that we would just do a half-hour interview for this one, Prajnanandi. And so we've come up to the just over the half-hour mark, I think. So we'll finish there. But just to say, we've got another two interviews planned, haven't we?
Yes, we have. And we're going to be talking, I think, about the huge topic of communication and friendship, which is a really big thing, but also about approaches to the transcendental. How do we meet the transcendental if standard approaches to myth don't work?
Gosh. Oh, we must talk about that.
Yeah.
Great.
Again, it's been great talking.
Yes, it's been really wonderful. Thank you very much again. And we'll see you next time.
Yes, thank you.